President Reagan was rushed to the hospital following assassination.
In Beirut today, a massive truck bomb exploded.
I think we've got a fantastic and remarkable capability here. We're really not too far, the human race isn't, from going to the stars.
This is Garapia, recorders are running.
DLT, OTC, perform AP restart.
To welcome all of you to the 25th anniversary of the space shuttle flight, and we're here today to honor two outstanding astronaut test pilots, John Young and Bob Crippen, which flew Columbia on her maiden voyage. We have more than 1,000 employees here at the Kennedy Space Center that were here for that first flight. How many folks in this audience were here for STS-1? So a number of you came out here today. Welcome. A couple of milestones that we had for Columbia was Columbia arrived at the Kennedy Space Center from California on March 24th, 1979. Now, of course, we had about 20 months worth of work that we had to do on Columbia before it was ready to fly. A vehicle rolled over to the VAB on November the 24th, 1980, rolled to the pad on December the 29th, 1980, and then launched on April 12th, 1981. On rollover day, John spoke to the employees and said, "We've come to pay tribute and give word of thanks and a hearty well done to the people who have worked on the spaceship. It's a beautiful vehicle." You know, it's the same work. This workforce is getting ready to do another launch, STS-121, coming up here very soon. And I will tell you that the dedication that was put into STS-1, that same dedication, that same attention to detail is going in to the next flight that we're going to fly, the next return to flight. I just like to thank all of you for the hard work that you do, and for the discipline, and the unbelievable dedication you put into this vehicle. You know, I could introduce John Young and Bob to you. I read their bios, and I could tell you we could go on and on and on. I think the first thing I would tell you is John Young, when he flew on STS-1, it was his fifth flight. I think that kind of tells you everything right there. So, and Bob Crippen, he became an astronaut in 1969, and he was working on Apollo-Soyuz. He also worked on a space lab as backup and support crew, and then his first flight was STS-1, and then he flew four more times after that. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce John Young and Bob Crippen.
Sure nice to see everybody out here. I see there's a lot of gray-headed folks out here. How many people in here, again, for a show of hands, worked on STS-1?
Wow. I think they all deserve a hand.
How many people in here worked on the American-Russian docking mission? Anybody do that?
All right.
Yeah. How about Apollo? Any Gemini folks out there? All right. That's great. Well, I just like to say this about STS-1. When they brought it down here, it wasn't ready to fly. I mean, it hadn't even been built yet. The tiles kept falling off when they, and everybody knew we was in these meetings, and we'd sit in there and they'd say the tiles are going to fall off and they're going to zipper down and everything's going to go bad. And then they hadn't even developed densification, so the tiles were falling off at 4 and 5 PSI out there when y'all were working on putting them on. I think you had to put on more than 7,000 when it was here. Imagine that. And Bob and I got to participate in tests, end-to-end tests. We did a 27.5-hour end-to-end test where we opened and closed the payload bay doors and worked the software integrated into the vehicle so they thought it was flying into orbit and out, ascent, orbit, and entry. That's never been done again. Start the APUs in OPF. You know, start up the APUs in OPF and all that smoke and fire coming out. And they say if you can breathe hydrazine and gets in your lungs, you're dead. And of course, everybody in OPF breathed it. And we're still okay, right? Wasn't that fun? And we did things you'd never imagine. We had a flight readiness firing out there, and the engines worked just really good. And so it worked great. And then when we got back from flying the mission, Chris Kraft said it best. He said, we just got infinitely smarter. Now, what didn't we know when we flew? Well, we didn't have any idea about the capabilities and limitations of our wind tunnel tests, like the solid rocket motors' normal forces and the plume effects. They'd done it with little bitty scale models, and it had no effect on what those 3 million-pound thrust guys do, you know, on the real vehicles, which made it sort of pitch straight up. And then when we got into orbit and came back, we had no idea of what the real gas effects were on the vehicle, and we didn't know about the way it was going to operate. And we had a big side slip when we first did our first roll in, and if that side slip was 4 degrees, that there was too much yaw. The thing predicted there was too much yaw and not enough roll, and that was predicted by the pre-wind test, and actually was just the opposite. It was supposed to have been roll and no yaw, but they had to fix that next time or time after, because if we'd have kept that side slip in there and the trim integrator hadn't took it out, Kripp and I would have spun around a couple of times and we'd have been in the middle of the Pacific Ocean somewhere. Y'all have been looking for us. Yeah. And then when we came on back, we measured the way it rolled back and forth across the ground track, and we found out the lift-to-drag ratio was just like what they predicted at 40 degrees angle attack, which was amazing considering how little we knew. And then when we got down a little slower, it oscillated at 1.6 Mach number, where the roll coefficients went to zero, and we didn't have those aileron, we didn't have the amount of roll compared to the amount of yaw figured out right, and we figured that lately, so we had that oscillation. And then when I come down on final at Edwards, I wanted to find out what the lift-to-drag ratio was out of ground effect, and they said it was going to be 4.45. And the darn thing, you know what we'd done? They'd overestimated how much tile drag we're going to have. And that good old Columbia landed about 1,200 feet further down the runway than we thought it would based on the tile, because we had a lift-to-drag ratio of, instead of 4.45, we had 4.9. It was awesome. I mean, when you're talking about flying a vehicle with a real low lift-to-drag ratio, you do instantly everything right. After you've been up in space for 10, 11 days, doing instantly everything right is not a likely event. But anyway, so we had a lot of fun, and the thing rolled out, and we proved all these things out, and came back, and we're mighty grateful. And the work that y'all did enabled us to do that, because y'all paid every attention to every detail. Now, you know, work like run the APUs and orbital processing facility. Only an idiot would do that, right? And we did it. And we work with hypergols. And you know, hypergols are very dangerous propellants. But you know how to handle them, because when you mix them together, they burn. Unlike stuff they want to use called green propellants, they want to develop. They only want $200 million to develop them, and we get these green propellants. But y'all know how to use hypergols, and they're pretty safe operating things. But they're dangerous, and you have to be careful with them. And almost everything we do is dangerous. We work in atmospheres that are very unforgiving to human beings staying alive if they're not clear every time of what you're doing. So y'all just be careful and watch everything, because flying in space is dangerous, and working on a good old vehicle is dangerous. Ohms pods and a Ford RCS has got stuff in the tanks, you know, that if it leaks out, what they always told us, like, if you can breathe monomethyl hydrazine, you're dead. Well, try to hold your breath if you smell anything like it, I guess, while you're getting out of there. But I know when we fired Gemini 3, we fired the Gemini 3 because Gus wanted to fire it, and we fired RCS, and I breathed monomethyl hydrazine, and I'm still here. But, you know, so take it with a grain of salt. But it's a dangerous business we're in, but exploring space is really the key to the future. Now, everybody's worried about, are they going to be working in 5 or 10 years from now around here? If I could predict the future, and I hope that I can, there's no way we can finish up building that space station by 2010. You know, it's 2006 right now, and you got to fly 18 missions or so with a space shuttle till 2010. So we're going to have to keep flying it, and we're going to have to build a crew exploration vehicle at the same time. It's going to be a lot of fun, and I sincerely believe if the future goes the way it goes, and we fly the space shuttle till we get things done right on the space station, and we build a crew exploration vehicle and fly that, there's going to be more people working down here at the Cape rather than less. If I had to predict the future, I predict that's what will happen. I never had no luck predicting the future yet. But it might be people off this planet. It's the most important program that's going on in the United States of America and on this planet today. Because single planet species don't last. And right now we're a single planet species. When we develop all the technologies we need to develop to live and work on the moon and go on to Mars, then we will have developed the same technologies that will save the people that live on this planet, our future civilization. And everybody says, well, who cares about civilization? What we ought to care about is our kids and our grandkids. We ought to be working on future. You know, everybody's worried about 3 gallons of gallon gasoline. We ought to be worried about the future of electrical power that's non-alternative and non-polluting. We aren't, because nobody can think past, next year's gasoline trip. But, we ought to be working on a future, and that's what we're going to be doing when we get ready to go to the moon. If we learn to live and work on the moon, then we'll solve many problems that will protect people on this planet for the future. And I think that's a wonderful job opportunity for everybody in this room to have, because I think you'll be working a long time, and what you'll be doing is very important to your kids and your grandchildren. So, I won't bore you with any more disastrous talks about STS-1. I'll let Captain Bob tell you a few things about what he's thinking about it.
Well, first, thanks for all coming out and helping us celebrate the 21st anniversary of the shuttle. It's always a pleasure for me to be here at the Kennedy Space Center. It's my favorite place in the whole wide world. And and it's mainly because of you, greatest launch team in the world. You do the greatest work, and you've proven that time and time again. And I want to thank John again for allowing me to fly that first flight with him. The selection of crews has always been kind of mysterious. Nobody's ever sure how that worked, even as long as I was in the astronaut office. Now, John was a natural. As Bill mentioned, he had flown 4 times before. He was chief of the astronaut office, and the chief gets to pick who goes fly. So,
not exactly. Captain Crippen was in charge of 600 and something people down in California doing software. And guess what the space shuttle had? 110 pages of software. 110 pages, mind you. And he knew what every one of them did. And I sure didn't. And the worst mistake we made in the whole vehicle design was Captain Crippen was sitting over here, and I was sitting over there, and where they put the damn software, the computer switches? Right over me. And he knew all about it. Oh, well. Go ahead, Colonel.
I've always just been John's straight man, anyhow. But it was a real honor to get picked to go on that first one. John and I both were test pilot trained, and when you look at the space shuttle, it was a test pilot's dream. First, it had never flown in space in an unmanned fashion, which is the way we'd always previously done our launch vehicles. First time we used big solid rockets, first time we had a winged vehicle that was going to come back in and land at a runway and a number of other firsts. So I couldn't have picked a better flight to go on. And if you're a rookie and you're going on something like that, you want to go with an old pro. And so I was very fortunate to have an opportunity to go fly with John. And like he indicated, we got to train a lot longer than what we planned. I guess maybe we were just a little slow, but the main engines tended to blow up every time we tested them over at Stennis. And as he indicated, the thermal protection system, or these infamous tiles that we had, didn't stick on too well. And I recall, in fact, I was down here as well as John was when they brought Columbia in for the first time, and it looked pretty ratty. And they had less tiles on here than what it left out at Edwards. A few more had ripped off. And I remember Walt Caprian telling all of the other NASA centers it was going to take at least 2 years to get that thing ready to fly. And nobody else wanted to hear that, but Cappy was right. It did take us a couple of years, and John and I spent an awful lot of time in the simulators and in the training airplanes. We got somewhere like 1,500 approaches in our shuttle training airplane apiece. So we had lots of practice, and as he indicated, we did lots of tests down here at KSC, because we got a chance to touch the hardware and interface with people like yourselves who were working on it. I recall about a month. Yeah, about a month prior to the actual flight, we were doing a dry countdown demonstration test, which is essentially going through and everything that you do to launch the vehicle, except you don't fuel it. And John and I went through it, and the test worked out pretty well. We were in our big suits and all that, and we climbed out. But somebody had, not unusual for a test, had put a DEV in. And we ended up with the right hand not knowing what the left hand was doing. And we cleared six technicians into the aft end of the vehicle while we still had a nitrogen purge going on in the aft. And went in, five of them passed out immediately. One, luckily enough, didn't, so that he could call some help. But they never knew what hit them when you walk into a pure nitrogen atmosphere. And John Bornstead and Warren Cole died of that. The others recovered. First people to give their lives for the space shuttle. It is a dangerous business. And those of us that have worked around it a while know that. I know the people that work here at the Kennedy Space Center know that. It's always a chance. If you don't, you're not vigilant, that something's going to reach up and bite you in the behind. And I know you guys are focused on that. Don't lose that focus. John and I did a number of tests, and this vehicle being as complicated as it is, I fully anticipated that we were going to count down several times before we actually lifted off. We went out on April the 10th. Which some of you might remember, that was a little less than 2 weeks after Ronald Reagan was shot. It wasn't exactly a bright time. There'd been a number of other incidents going on. Reagan had just been president a few months, and he'd managed to finally free the hostages that we had over in Iran. It had been a long time since we'd flown. Since Skylab, we'd had one mission, the Apollo Soyuz. So there'd been a big gap down here. And so for the first time, I figured, hey, this thing's, we're just going to go in, climb in again, and sit here a while. And we sat there a while. We had a three-hour hold because we ran into a problem with the, John blaming it on me, I guess the computers weren't talking to one another. Maybe there's those switches up there, I'm not sure. We ended up strapped in on our backs for about 6 hours, and I still think they use that as the hold limit today for crews, which was enough time. So they finally let us out, and I figured, well, this is going to take them a few weeks to figure out. But we had some smart people that found out what the problem was, and sure enough, 2 days later, on April the 12th, we went in again. Now, some people over in Russia were saying that because that was just because we knew it was the anniversary of Yuri Gagarin's flight that we picked April the 12th, which is not true at all, but it just turned out that way. And I fully expected we were going to go down and count this thing down again and climb out of the vehicle. And George Page was launch director. Those of you who know George know he ran a strict launch control room. I mean, you didn't dare do anything untowards. In fact, during the count, I guess it was part of the coming out of the L-minus 9 minute hole that George even strung the thing out a little bit longer and just trying to make sure everybody was calmed down and not getting too anxious. But again, I didn't think we were going to go. We hadn't started the APUs yet or anything. So count goes on down, and it got down to about 1 minute, I guess, about 1 minute to go. And that was when I turned to John and I said, I think we might do it. And about that time, my heart rate went up to over 130. John stayed down in a nice cool 90, which I've also heard that was what his heart rate was when he landed on the moon.
I was too old for it to go any faster.
But sure enough, we actually didn't, except for George's extending the hole a little bit longer, we went off right on time. Didn't have any other problems. And you know, all of the other launch vehicles had kind of gotten up and lumbered a little bit, especially the Saturn V. Boy, when the shuttle, as you well know, when you light those solids, you're headed someplace. You just hope it's in the right direction. And my eyes were about that big, and I was sort of holding on. And it's best thing I can liken it to. It's a little bit like a catapult shot coming off an aircraft carrier. It's about an extra G and a half, and it. So you get a nice solid push coming off the pad, and you do the big roll maneuver, which is all expected, and everything's going just fine, except we have this display on the computer that tells us what our trajectory is supposed to be, and we're going above it, quite a bit above it. And sure enough, it was part of what John was talking about earlier in the aerodynamics. The vehicle turned out to have more lift than what had been predicted. It wasn't really a problem from a performance standpoint. We weren't tight as far as performance was concerned. There was some shaking going on in the vehicle, but it wasn't a violent ride. But it was still exciting for a first-time guy. And then we got to the SRB burnout, and we'd been, you know, I guess we were hearing the noise of the structure, but it was noisy, it was shaking, and then all of a sudden it's gone. But there's supposed to be still three main engines burning back there. And I couldn't hear them, and I didn't feel them. The instruments told us they were still burning, though. So, but it got my attention there for a moment. But so from 8.5 minutes from sitting out on the pad out there to going 17,500 miles an hour, if folks over at Universal or Disney could duplicate that, they'd get a lot more visitors. That's one heck of, it is a heck of a ride. And John and I got up on orbit, and first thing they had. They didn't make John do it, but they made me take some medication because of this space sickness thing, and I was a rookie going up for the first time. So I was moving around slow, keeping my head oriented straight up, just so, because the last thing I wanted to do was to get up and hurl in space on my first time up. But we got up, went back to open up the payload bay doors, and opened those up, and all of a sudden, looking back on the OMS pods, some stuff missing back there. Some of these tiles had managed to pop off during NASA. And we radioed that down to the ground. Truthfully, at least from my standpoint, I knew that all of the critical tiles had been pull tested back here and that they hadn't pulled on those particular tiles because they weren't critical from a reentry standpoint. They were critical from a reuse standpoint. But we. I know there was lots of excitement going on back at Houston and probably here at KSC at that particular time over those, because if those are missing, then we got some on the bottom that are missing. Well, John and I didn't want to hear about that part because wasn't a darn thing we could do about it anyhow. But it was a great flight. I learned that important for my subsequent missions that the commander gets to set or float and look out the window and take pictures, because as a PLT, I was busting my buns doing all kinds of stuff. But so I took advantage of that on my my subsequent flights. I got lots of pictures, and I know John got lots of great pictures from STS-1. Coming in on entry after a little over 2 days, it's fantastic, beautiful. It's hard to describe. It was kind of a pink glow around the vehicle when we were still on the dark side, when the little ion started to get a little angry outside, but it wasn't a big fiery thing. Imagine first time, I think I said worse the remark when we first got in touch with the ground, that what a way to come to California, because it was an extremely awesome ride coming in. John took control of the vehicle around Mach 5, wasn't that right, John, somewhere on that, and did a couple of the roll reversals to make sure the thing was flying right, and then flew around, and he greased it on at Edwards, as only John can, and made a beautiful landing. It was certainly one of the highlights of my life. And
highlight of my life is when Bob put the landing gear down.
I think John was backing me up just in case I screwed that part up.
That's right. We both got to push those buttons just in case.
just in case. But that was a kickoff of what's been a fantastic history for the shuttle. When you look back over its lifetime, it is a magnificent vehicle. Haven't built anything like it since, and I don't know if we ever will. We married putting up to 7 people in the vehicle, along with the largest cargo we could carry into orbit, and we've been able to do some fantastic things. You know, if you just look back over the flights we've flown, well, we don't do it anymore, but we put up some Department of Defense satellites that I can't talk about, but I tell you, I think they significantly contributed to us winning the Cold War. It was...
He just talked about them, didn't he?
I won't say anymore. They might shoot me. But they were very important. We did a number of other things from a planetary standpoint. Magellan going to map out Venus. Actually, we ended up with a better surface map of Venus for a while than we had of Earth, but then we corrected that by flying a synthetic aperture radar on board the shuttle and mapping the Earth's surface. Galileo has done some beautiful things around Jupiter and its moons. We also have learned more about the universe with satellites like Compton Gamma Ray Observatory, Chandra, and Hubble. Revolutionized what we know about astronomy, and we couldn't have done it without the shuttle. We're continuing to learn. We certainly building the space station, that couldn't have been done without the shuttle. It is a marvelous vehicle with what it can do, and continues to do. And you people are the ones that make it happen. You and thousands of others around the U.S. are really part of that program. And I know from my standpoint, it's been a pleasure to be a part of it. And I enjoyed working with each and every one of you, and hope to see many more flights out of the shuttle. Thank you very much.
You know, one of the things we say is that each and every flight of the shuttle is a test flight. I think the ultimate test flight was that first one, though. One heck of an accomplishment. We have a great opportunity to be able to ask these folks some questions. So what we'd like to do is just open it up to the audience and have you ask them some questions if you have any.
Don't make them too hard, though.
Okay, I see somebody back here in the back. We're on TV, folks, so...
John and Crip, I'd first like to say you guys are legends. It's a pleasure having you guys back here at KC. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And secondly, I'd like to ask you guys what kind of advice you have for NASA as we prepare for another era in the space program and going on to Mars?
John's the one that's the expert on that.
Well, for the past couple of years since I retired, I've been working on a crew exploration vehicle. I've been giving them a very lot of advice because, you know, we actually did go to the moon. And I think Dr. Gilruth is right. When we go back, we'll find out how difficult it was. Well, you talk to these folks and you give them advice, it's like talking to a wall. But I don't quit, so I'll keep giving advice, and we're going to make that crew exploration vehicle something that will carry people to the moon and haul people to Mars and be a reliable ascent, abort, and reliable entry vehicle with abort capability all the way to orbit and all the way back down, and we'll make that happen. Sure will. It's going to take a lot of testing, a lot of work, and a lot of really interesting things that we've already done back in the Apollo programs, but we're going to have to do them all again with a new kind of vehicle. And with modern electronics and stuff, somebody showed me how many words of software was going to be in there. We went to the moon and came back with 36,000 words with, you know, 3,000 words of erasable. And I don't want to tell you how many, but it's approaching 500,000 words to go to the moon this time. It must be more difficult. It's going to be a lot of fun anyway, and we'll give them advice. But I do believe that getting people off this planet and doing the things we have to do, developing the technology we need to live and work on, learn to live and work on the moon and on Mars, are the very technologies that will improve the life of people on this planet. For example, terraforming. Back in Houston, we've worked growing wheat. 38 bushel acre.
They also did that down at KSC, or I don't know. Don't
yeah, they've been doing it, but I mean, they've been growing wheat in Houston with adding CO2 and additional light, and using these, these Iceland seeds and stuff. They're going 45 days from seed to seed, and 38 bushels of wheat is a good crop. They're growing wheat at 1,000 bushels an acre. You got to revolutionize farming. They've even developed fertilizer made out of basalt stuff that will allow, it's regenerative fertilizer, and if you use that on your plants up and down the Mississippi instead of leaving the Mississippi off the edge of the Mississippi, which is, you know, it's killing all the fish out there because they're dumping fertilizer in there, this stuff wouldn't do it. So it costs more to use it, but it saves the environment. And that's what we ought to be all about, looking at saving the environment for the future. I mean, what we're worried about right now is $3 a gallon gasoline, right? We're worried about that. Yeah, it's going to get worse. Well, it's 45 years from now, 2050. If India and China all want two cars in every garage, and there's a lot of them folks, the amount of fossil fuels required, according to Space Command, would be 900 million barrels of oil a day. Well, there isn't 900 million barrels of oil a day, so we got to look at other things. And the moon is one place to get them. I mean, Jack Smith's book says you can go to the moon and develop helium-3 and make uninterrupted with a lot of electrical power. But there's other people who know that you can go to the moon and send electrical power back to the Earth like we were going to do back in the 70s with our big satellites. In low Earth orbit, except their aircraft carrier satellites, and you can send this stuff back to Earth, and it's reliable, unpolluting, and it comes back no matter what's happening to Earth. And there are potentially bad things can happen. I mean, you know, you get a big asteroid in the Atlantic Ocean. I hate to say how low Florida is, but it isn't above 100 meters, and if you have better than 100 meter wave, everybody's going to be very bad off. And not to mention us kids in Houston, which is, I mean, I'm 10 feet above sea level right out there now. And so it's going to be a bad thing. So we have to learn to live with that kind of stuff and do something about it. We have to learn how to deflect asteroids and watch them and do all that kind of stuff. And of course, it's high-risk business. Living on Earth is high-risk, too. We have to work it.
Sure, we got some other questions out there.
Roy Tharp down here.
Well, I see, Crip. I Thank you very much for the comments regarding the safety and reflecting back to STS-1 and also how it applies to us today. And when your morale gets low, one of the things that you two guys did during those early days with all of that testing, you were here and very visible at KSC. And when we were working a lot of those shifts, you were in the VAB, you were in the OPF, you were at the pad, you were in the firing room. And so one of those legacies, and that's you guys set the bar for being very visible at the work site. So one of the things we appreciate you all coming back, even though it's 25 years, it's a silver anniversary, we still got hair, but we're still out here slamming away. So thanks to you two guys, and also, you know, the advice for the younger astronauts, just like you talked about these folks who are going to be here finishing the job that we started, but your advice to the new astronauts that are coming, when you do give that, tell them they need to come around and talk to the workforce at KSC.
We'll do it.
Okay, next.
Now, this group is not that bashful. I know too many of you.
We got one back here in the back.
What was it like landing on the moon?
What was it like landing,
On the moon? Well, we practiced a lot for that. We had a thing called the Lunar Landing Training Vehicle. And it'd come down, and you know, it had a jet engine in it. It would fly just, it had a software program in it that flew just like that. And you'd come down and land. And it didn't have but like, at the most, 12 minutes of gas in it. So you had to come down real fast. And we practiced that a lot, and it worked great. And it just landed just like that on the moon. And we had actually more minutes. I had about 60 seconds of gas in my machine when I landed on the moon. Come down, land straight. You look out the window, you can see where you're going. You can fly like a helicopter. You don't need a radar altimeter because you can see the shadow coming down. You can tell how fast you're going. But, you know, it was no go with no radar altimeter. Landing on the moon was great. And we only knew the area that we were landing in, to 20 meters. That's how bad our photography was. And now they're going back to Mars. And they're going to have the surface photography to centimeters. They must be a bunch of sissies. But anyway, you know, land on the moon, very straightforward because you can see what you're doing. And you like to use human beings in situations where if the automatic system, like the radar or something, fails, you can put human beings in the loop and go get the mission done. That's what, you know, that's what pilot folks do. They can rendezvous and dock, and they don't need no radar altimeter or no guidance. They can do it backup, and that's what we ought to do.
That's what pilots were pilots for.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what you pay them for. In case the automatic system's not working, you just take over and keep right on trucking. Because, you know, if you're on the moon and you can't dock with something when you get off the surface of the moon and come back and you can't dock, well, you're going to be up there a long, long time. So you know, I have to back that kind of stuff up.
I don't know if some of you remember it. It was on Apollo 16 when John and Charlie Duke were on the moon that Nixon gave approval for us to go build a space shuttle. And I think John had some appropriate remarks while he was on the surface at that time, but saying something like we needed to go build that vehicle.
Said we needed that shuttle pretty bad. And I didn't really know what I was saying. But, you know, flying a wing launch vehicle, we'd never thought about it. We didn't realize how complicated it was going to be, but it worked out. I'm telling you, it'll do things that nothing else can do. What else can haul 40,000 pounds to the space station and bring that much payload back? There's nothing can do it.
Got a question in the back?
Yeah, is it disappointing for y'all to see that the whole evolution of, say, a winged returnable vehicle is going by the boards in the interest of what, just absolute safety? I mean, is that required? It seems like we've come so far to go back to landing with parachutes in a desert in a capsule after, you know, Buck Rogers would have us, you know, landing like airplanes after all this time. Is that kind of disappointing after pioneering this?
You won't try that, John?
Well, I think it's really just building an escape system. that'll work. That's what the crew exploration vehicle is, an abort escape system that'll work. And I think for going back to the moon, if you want to go straight away to the moon, that's the best way to do it with an ascent launch vehicle. Because we talked about one time sending a space shuttle to the moon, but they're in a rocket big enough. And we haven't built a rocket big enough to put that baby in the moon orbit.
Yes, we paid a high price to see the shortcomings of it, even though it's an incredible vehicle. I mean, with the losses we've had in the terms of the program.
Well, flying in space is going to continue to be dangerous, whether you're flying it with a shuttle or a CEV or whatever they come up with next. I personally think it was a remarkable being able to marry a large crew with the cargo and its capability on orbit. We couldn't have built a space station that we have now that we're assembling without something like the shuttle. But as John said, you don't want to take the shuttle going to the moon. That's just not the right way to do it. And all good things must come to an end. I'm not sure exactly when the shuttle will come to an end as far as utilizing it, but it has taught us some valuable lessons. And one of them is it's desirable to have some kind of crew escape system in it, and the shuttle was just not a vehicle to be able to do that. It has been a fantastic machine. You folks have done a super job of keeping it flying. And yes, we've learned some hard lessons. But from my standpoint, we haven't lost the last humans flying in space. If we continue to do it, it's going to happen again. It's part of the price that you pay.
One last question, folks. Right here.
Hi. What was the biggest surprise you had during the STS mission, either from an operational point of view or just experiencing the first reusable space vehicle?
Well, I'll mention a couple of them on the technical standpoints. Unbeknownst to John and I, when we lifted off, we broke a strut up in the nose of the vehicle that holds the forward reaction control system because the shock wave from the solids when they ignited bouncing off the mobile launch platform came back and socked the vehicle good. And consequently, we put in some water logs out there under the vehicle that were used for that all the subsequent flights. I mentioned earlier we lofted above on trajectory because the vehicle had more lift. It also proved again, as John indicated, on landing. But as Chris Kraft said after we got back, we were infinitely smarter after we had flown the vehicle because essentially the system worked, and that was the most valuable thing I think that we got out of it, and that's why you do a test flight. John, you want to add anything to that?
I'm not sure what I was surprised about the most. I think maybe the surprise was that it worked so well as it did. I mean, we practiced in a simulator, and Neil Hutchison said we did 500 practice getting to orbit 500 times in the simulator, and we practiced. Everything worked. I was really surprised. And, you know, and I, 5 years, about 5 years ago, I learned, we'd looked at the bottom of the vehicle. About 5 years ago, I learned that they had a gap filler hanging loose on the, out in front of the right-hand main landing gear, and the hot gas got in the wheel well and buckled right-hand main landing gear door. Well, you just can't get hot gas in your wheel well because that's where your hydraulic lines live and that's where your two big wheels are, so I think we're also very lucky, apparently, because when it happened, it must have happened so late that they didn't get much hot gas in there, and it must have been a low flow. Thank goodness to that. That's a nice surprise to have 5 years, 20 years after you've flown.
Okay, John and Bob, thank you all very much for sharing with us. What we'd like to do right now is I'd like to ask you all to stand up and come over here. We have a little video that we want to show. Jim Kennedy couldn't be with us today, so he did tape a message, and he'd like to share some things with you and a dedication for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill, and good afternoon to all of you, and welcome to this very special event. We are gathered here in the Launch Control Center right outside Firing Room 1 for a very special event. I think the two gentlemen next to me need no introduction, but in case you're a new employee, you might not know Norm Carlson, who stands to my immediate left, was the NASA test director for STS-1, and Bob Seek, most recently the launch director, was project flight engineer for the shuttle. Take it away, Bob.
Well, John and Crip, this is a tribute not only to you, but the whole KSC team that was part of the STS-1 effort. As you know, it took thousands of hours of work from dedicated men and women to pull off your mission. And expectedly, it took a lot of work here at KSC before we even had the privilege of processing the flight hardware. We were working at it for years, getting the facilities, the ground support equipment, and the tools together necessary to process the flight hardware. And it took a couple of years to get the flight hardware to the point where it could be committed for launch. Those men and women, they didn't have to have a highly visible job to be an important member of this team. Whether it was work done here in the control center for test checkout operations, or debugging all the software that we had to write for the automated programs, of course over in the orbiter processing facility, assembling Columbia and all that tile work that some of us remember, the work in the VAB on the external tank, the solid rocket motors, the engine shop, and of course all of the work on the facilities and ground support equipment. It was a marathon effort, and we always considered you to be members of the team also. You spent a lot of time here helping us with our test planning, a lot of time in the cockpit during test operations, and most importantly, on the floor with the workers that were putting out the high quality products. So you were the highly visible members of the team that we were all privileged to be members of, and this is a tribute to you and the whole team. We're doing this in the Launch Control Center next to Firing Room 1 because this is not only where all the test and checkout was performed, but where the launch team members were privileged to put the finishing touches on that great effort. Not surprisingly, the first time we went through the launch count, we scrubbed because of the proverbial glitch. We were used to that. We had a lot of unplanned holds and scrubs during our simulated launches leading up to that. So it was somewhat of a surprise the second time through that we made it right through to T0. Of course, we were ecstatic about that. And as they say, the rest is history. And that's best addressed by Norm Carlson.
Hey, we'll give you a little bit of the history of Firing Room 1. It was probably the most popular firing room during the Apollo era and continued to be so during the shuttle era. Of the four launches that stick to my mind was the very first Saturn V launch, which was in November of 1967. And it was launched only 10 months after the Apollo fire over on 34. Of course, the next one that comes to my mind is the Borman mission in December 68, which was an all-up mission manned that circled the moon. And the next one, of course, was Apollo 11. And Apollo 11, of course, was our first lunar landing. And then, of course, last but not least, the Young Crippen mission, STS-1. I would say that the flight of STS-1 utilizing Firing Room 1 was probably the most daring flight that we had ever attempted to put in Earth orbit. And I say that because there was no other preceding flights that were unmanned. It was the very first flight. John and Bob got on and we flew. I think everybody had hold of their seats pretty tight. One story I'd like to tell has to do with John Young. I was in the Firing Room 1. I was briefing him and some other people, just in general how we operate the firing room. And when I got through, I said, John, I've got time. If you and your group would like to go to the pad, I'll take you to the top of the stack. And John said, no, I'm afraid of heights. Yes, Bob and John, it was a real pleasure in working with you all over the years. And there's no two people that's more deserving of this honor.
Thank you, Norman Carlson. Thank you, Bob Sieg, for those touching memories of STS-1, the ultimate flight test. And now, John Young and Bob Crippen, it's our pleasure on behalf of all of your friends at the Kennedy Space Center to unveil a plaque commemorating your historic flight and your successes with NASA. Norm, Bob, if you'll unveil it, I'll read the inscription. You can see the STS-1 Columbia patch, and below it says, on the 25th anniversary of STS-1, April 12th, 1981, the first orbital test flight of NASA's Space Shuttle program, we proudly name Firing Room 1 the Young Crippen Firing Room, in tribute to John W. Young, Commander, and Robert L. Crippen, Pilot, dated April 2006. Congratulations, gentlemen, and if we could move behind us, we'll have one more unveiling to complete the ceremony here. You can see on the glass door leading into Firing Room 1, Norm and Bob are going to drop this, and you'll see that this room is indeed named the Young Crippen Firing Room. So again, to Bob and John, congratulations. It's a privilege for us at the Kennedy Space Center to share in your special day. Good luck.
Well, again, folks, thank you, Bob. Thank you for coming, John. Thank you for being back here at the Kennedy Space Center. Folks, thanks, everyone, for coming out today. Y'all have a great afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.